There you go. Good evening, folks. We're gonna get going here. It's 6:02, so nice and prompt. This evening's lecture, again brought to you by the NORCAT Educational and the Regional Business Center, is on financial planning. So joining us this evening are Joe Reilly and James Rudo from FCR, Freelandt Caldwell Reilly. Joe and James are both LU grads and chartered professional accountants. They work with local entrepreneurs and small businesses to ensure they have the right financial information at the right time to make the right business decisions. So here you are, guys. Stage is all yours.
Thank you. Okay. As mentioned, we're from FCR. My name is James. This is Joe. Come on. And FCR is an accounting firm here in Sudbury. And we're actually celebrating 25 years of service this past year. We've been doing this presentation for NORCAT, I think, for like the last 10 years. So but this is the first time for us to from Joe and myself here. So anyways, just like to get a feel for where you guys are at in your program here, or as far as like the businesses you're starting up. Does anybody here actually have like a business in the works, or okay?
And business. Anybody have an idea for a business? You're trying to get up and down?
Yeah, okay. Okay. So that's the majority. Okay. And as far as financial planning, has anyone seen a financial plan, created one, ever heard of one, or ever done one? Okay, so this stuff's going to be pretty new for most people, right? What we're hoping that you take away from today's lecture is obviously to learn a few new things. We're going to be touching on quite a few areas, but it's going to be more general. A lot of these topics you're going to need to, to go into more detail, you need to specifically know what type of business you're looking to run. So we're going to see a lot of higher level information here. But we hope that you consider some things that you might not have thought of before. Some things that are going to help you out when you're going through your program, but also when you actually start taking those first steps and running your business. So if you have any questions throughout, we'd actually prefer to,
just jump in. Don't have to put your hand up first.
We'll make it more like a conversation if we can. If not, we'll have some time at the end also to go through some questions. So as far as what's on tap for today, so here's the agenda. So obviously we want to talk about why we're here, why we're interested in this information at all. What is a financial plan? So we're going to look at the components, what makes up a financial plan. There's a few key areas that we want to go over. And we're going to be looking at forecasting, budgeting. And when we get into those, we'll go into a little more detail about how you actually can create a sales forecast and an expense budget. And we're really going to talk a lot about the cash flow budget. Joe's going to come in towards the end and go over that, a solid example of what a cash flow budget looks like. And Joe's also going to go over some financing options for you. Okay, so as this slide shows, the financial plan is obviously a critical part of your business plan. Do we have anyone here that's familiar with a business plan or what that might be a bit of? Okay, so obviously you're going to have a lot of market research that you've done in order to understand what you might be looking at when you get your product going or your business started. You're going to do some industry analysis. You're going to get to know some of your costs that are out there. You're also going to analyze some of your competition, how you're going to feel for what you're going to be up against. The financial part of this is what basically ties it all together. So you need those hard facts, you need those financial numbers to actually put your plan into action. And to basically get a sense of whether or not this idea that you have or this opportunity is actually worth pursuing. And you're going to see that on this next slide. This point here with the top of it says financial viability. So what that means is does this business opportunity make sense financially? I'm assuming that most of you are looking to start a for-profit business, right? Looking to generate earnings. So does this do that for you? You need to have that financial plan in order to find that out, right? Are you going to be generating profit? Maybe not to start, but how long down the road is it going to take you to earn a profit? And then how are you going to be able to sustain that profit and keep generating that? So the financial plan is obviously critical for that. Beyond that, on a daily, monthly, or yearly basis, you're going to need your financial plan in order to make decisions. So when you start up, you're going to be looking at decisions about some assets that you might need to purchase, or when you're starting inventory, right? And then beyond that, you're also going to be looking at decisions about possibly, you know, what sales price you can offer people if you need to decrease it or can you increase it? What type of expenses are maybe you overpaying? Where's an area where you can cut costs? So decision making on an ongoing basis, that's all going to be driven by your financial plan as well. Trend analysis is another important thing that you can get from your financial plan. You might be running a business that's cyclical, let's say. So in other words, you have like heavy sales during the summer months, maybe quieter in the winter, something like that. You're gonna be able to see those trends and how they affect your bottom line or your profit. You see that through this also. I like this point about evaluating your ROI. So that's your return on investment. In other words, the profit, the earnings that you're going to generate for the initial cash outlay or resources that you put into your business. And the reason that's interesting is because, you know, you've got this opportunity that you want to pursue or this business idea. You really have to be able to evaluate that against, you know, other possible uses of your cash and your resources. You know, is the return that you're going to get on this venture worth your time, worth your money, or is there somewhere else that you'd be better off putting those resources into?
Just on that, to break it down, the way I was looking, if I have $100,000 in cash and I can go buy a piece of equipment and earn $1,000, or can I put it into a GIC and not do the amount of work that I need to do with the equipment and make 2% on my money? That's what James is talking about. Evaluate where you're going to put your money and which one's going to give you the best return. It's basically for the least amount of effort, right? So you don't want to go through all the effort of running a business if you're only going to get X of the amount of, at the end of the year. And you can take that $100,000 and put it in some other safe investment like a GIC and get the same return. So it's all about evaluating options, basically.
Exactly. Okay, so what makes up a financial plan? Now, again, in this type of area, it really is specific to the type of business that you're looking to run. But for the most part, you're going to see these four areas in every financial plan that you're creating. I'd say the capital asset budget might be one that's pretty specific, right? Mm-hmm. The type of business. Yeah, let's say like it's a manufacturing business, you need to purchase a large piece of equipment or get a building or something. But
obviously, much different than if you're trying to create a software application, right? Software, if you're a good programmer, all you need is a new computer. Or maybe one, I don't know, too much about software. But.
Okay, so, but in every financial plan, you're going to see the sales forecast and expense budget. And a really important area that we're going to talk about later is the cash flow budget. So we'll really go into detail on that. Typically, like it says here, the time frame would be 3 or 5 years for a financial plan. But since we're talking about startup businesses here, you really want to have your plan based on a monthly basis. It's just so critical to manage things like your cash flow on a regular basis and consistently be updating it and using that information, like I said, to make decisions. And you're going to see how it's integrated with the rest of your business plan. For example, like I mentioned about the market research that you're going to get. So just in a general way, your market research will have information about the number of units that you might sell if you're selling a product. And information about the selling price that you might be able to charge. Well, that's going to drive your sales forecast. So with that information, you'll be able to get a revenue figure, so you're going to be able to put that into your sales forecast. And again, the last point is really important. It's got to be consistently updated. So as you're actually going through your business in those first few months, weeks, months, years, you're going to look back at your budget, you're going to be able to update that information with the actual results that you see. So that's critical because the more timely the information, the better decisions you're going to be able to make. Okay, so does anyone have any questions at this point? Okay, so looking at a sales forecast. So this is the most critical part of the financial plan, and it also happens to be the most difficult to project. It's important because it ends up driving all the rest of the information that you have here. For your sales figure, obviously sales minus expenses is going to give you your profit, but it's also going to drive your cash flow analysis that you're going to do. Your revenue coming in is going to be very similar to the cash that you have from you. So it's important, but again, it is difficult because you're putting so many assumptions into this. Your market research is going to hopefully fill in some of those unknowns that you have, but you're always going to have those assumptions. assumptions there. So again, using your market data, you want to have strong market research in order to build this forecast. And considering some things that might happen, I guess it's referred to as like planning for things that you can't really plan for. Like try to compensate for things that might happen. This is an example here, considering order backlog, or you know what an example you see like a.
Well, I think just contingency in general, right? Like whenever you're coming up with one of these forecasts, the key is to be reasonable. There's no point in saying you're gonna have $3 million in sales in your first month. It's not realistic.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not gonna be good for you because you're not gonna meet your goals. It's not gonna be good if you're going to a bank or an investor to ask for money to help generate those sales. So at the end of the day, it's all about just being realistic and, like you said, planning for contingency. So the contingency could literally be, I thought I was going to sell 50 widgets and I only sold 40 for no particular reason other than the fact that it was a projection, right? Nobody knows the future, so I think it's just about being realistic.
You don't want to overestimate a situation like this.
And you want to be optimistic because, you know, you're trying to get this thing off the ground. You've got to be excited about it. And you want to drive yourself to try and attain those goals, but you don't want to be overly optimistic, right? There's sort of a sweet spot you want to hit. And usually market data and research will help dictate what those numbers come out to.
Yeah. And you're also going to want to consider some of the trends like I spoke about before. Again, if you have a cyclical business, right, it's seasonal. Like if you're in a retail situation and you know you're really busy around Christmas and then it dies down in the new year, things like that have to be built into that sales plan. You really want to have as much of that as you can to try and again project things that might happen. And obviously, like Joe was saying, you want to be conservative with those estimates. So the last point there says, review your budget with your accountant. You want to get feedback on your assumptions. That just goes back to what I said earlier about consistently coming back to your budget and trying to update that with time and information. Again, like something I forgot to mention is that your financial plan is really going to be used as a tool to measure where you're at. So you come up with these budgets, right, an idea or an expectation, and then you have what your actual results are. So you're consistently comparing those two. And you want to see what the variances are, right? If you thought you were going to sell a certain amount, you didn't, you know, why did you not? Or if you sold more, you know, how did that happen? Why? If your costs weren't where you thought they were going to be, you know, why was that? What can you do to change those things?
Because all that information is going to help you do is plan for the future forward, right? So if 1 month goes by and you realize, okay, there's no way I'm going to be able to sell this amount of product at this cost. All that means is, it doesn't mean that everything comes collapsing down. It just means I need to revise my plan for February, March, April, May. You learn from January, right?
Okay, so an expense budget. This is kind of looking at the other side. This is money going out, obviously. Here's some things that, this might be more of a refresher, things you've seen in other accounting courses before, but there's a difference that you need to know between your variable expenses and your fixed expenses. So variable, again, are those that go up and down depending on the number of units you sell. At that point, that's a lot easier to think about in a situation where you might be manufacturing a product. So you have like the material, labor that went into creating the product. Every time you sell one, then those would be the cost of sales, right? Those would be a variable cost. It'd go up and down depending on how many units you actually sell. And that's in contrast to your fixed expenses. So there's things that are just going to happen every period that you know. A good example of that is rent, obviously. Whether or not you sell 1,000 widgets or 5 widgets, the rent's going to be the same, right? There's some things to think about also, startup costs, and we'll look at that and then we'll talk about the cash flow again. But those initial startup costs, if you need to purchase inventory, if you need to purchase some other materials or machines or equipment. And if you need to start costing, there's a startup cost when it comes to salaries as well. You're going to want to be able to distinguish those from the other costs. So where it says want versus need, I guess it's important, obviously, when you're coming up with these examples, again, to be realistic and really think about the things that are necessary for running your business. And again, try to be conservative with your estimates, right? You don't want to be underestimating your expenses. You're going to run into problems the same way you would when you're overestimating your sales.
Yeah. Hey,
yeah.
Did you
So you're going to go back into some of these in more detail and start a process to go through, or I have just a question about incorporation fees.
Mm-hmm.
If our company will probably do business here in Australia.
Okay.
Can you get one incorporation for all of that, or do you have to be incorporated in each country?
That is, it's a good question. It's would be a complex answer. It more leans towards the taxation issues that you would run into, because if you're going to be operating in Australia, you might be deemed to have a branch there, or the question is, do I incorporate an Australian company there? So that's more of a tax question, but I think you can definitely, if you're talking just in terms of fees, you can most likely have an Ontario corporation, if you're an incorporated company, that operates part of its operation in Australia. I can't give you the answer whether that's tax advantageous or not right now, but
yeah.
You could do it, or you can say, you know what, I'm going to have a company in both countries, which definitely complicates things. Even a branch is complicated, so I would definitely say seek some tax advice before you go into Australia, or even if you're in there already, maybe just call someone, because there's multiple issues that happen once you cross borders, right?
So you haven't been incorporated yet, so we're just thinking about...
No, you're thinking about the right things, and if that's part of your plan, I would definitely say talk to a tax advisor to make sure it's structured properly from the onset,
yeah.
As opposed to getting into it a year from now and then you get a tax bill from the Australian government that you didn't know was going to come, right? Which could cause cash flow issues, right?
Any other questions? Okay, so this is going into a little more detail on how you're going to come up with your expense budget. You want to start with some of those fixed expenses, like you said. Rent was one example, property taxes, salaries and wages is usually one you can predict each month. It's going to be an ongoing expense. A good way to look at your variable expenses, again, is to think your way through the product that you're selling and try to piece together, like I said, if it's parts, material, labor that's going into the products. Try to just piece it together and then think of the actual process that it takes to sell a unit. Looking at that sales side will give you an idea of what the expenses would be that are related to that.
One thing on the variable expenses, I think you just got to step back. Because like I know in here we're saying, you know, salaries and labor is something that probably could be variable, but it could also be fixed. So let's say I'm running a construction company and revenues are at $5 million. The CEO is going to get paid $100,000 a year no matter what happens. If revenues go up to $10 million, I'll probably have to hire additional labor staff. So it's like the labor staff is variable, but your head office staff is fixed, right?
Yeah.
So you almost just got to step back and think line item by line item. If my volume grows, is this expense going to grow? If my volume grows or comes down, is this expense going to stay the same? And that'll dictate whether it's variable or fixed.
And again, you want to be conservative, but you want to be realistic with these estimates. So you don't want to underestimate what your expenses are actually going to be. And just like we said with the sales forecast, try to plan for the unplanned. Try to think of those contingencies, things that you might run into. Leave a buffer zone so that you know you're able to hit your targets, or you're able to leave some room for something that might happen. Okay, so the capital asset budget. So this again depends on the type of business that you're running. If you're looking at a manufacturing product, you might be looking at buying a large piece of equipment or a building to get your operations going. For those of you, again, just as a refresher to know what a capital asset is, I'm not sure if everyone is aware of that, but it's something that's going to be long-term in nature. So something you're going to purchase today, and it's going to help you generate revenue for years and years to come. Not so, as opposed to something that you just use up in 1 year and really only benefit you in that one. So buildings, equipment, vehicles, those are things that you'd be looking at as far as capital items. And again, it is typically, I mean, depending on the business you're running, it could be the biggest cash outlay that you have to plan for. Not only are you planning for the initial outlay, but you're planning for what might happen or what will happen in the future. Eventually, a piece of equipment is going to wear out, it's going to break down, it's going to need to be replaced. So you have to have a plan for when it happens, how you're going to be able to handle that situation. You can also use these capital asset budgets to make decisions of whether or not it's advantageous to purchase capital as an asset as opposed to lease one, right? You can obviously, the same example, purchase equipment, right? You can purchase it or you can work on leasing it, and you can use this information to gauge, you know, which is a better approach to take.
Yeah, like let's say you need an excavator, you have one job and it's going to be 3 months. You probably don't want to go spend $300,000 on a new excavator to use it for 3 months. You might be better off just renting it from a company for 3 months, right? So it's those types of decisions. And I think when you do have, you know, a business idea or a startup, this is the hardest part to secure financing for, right? Like realistically with a startup, depending on what it is, the capital assets are what's gonna cost you a lot of money day one. You know what's gonna drive revenues and profit in the future, but that's basically, where do I come up? I got a great idea, where do I come up with 500 grand though, right? That's the toughest part. So if you have a very structured capital asset budget, and you can go to a bank or a financer and say, listen, here's my idea, I think it's gonna work. Here's what I need. They'd rather you know what you need as opposed to show up kind of empty-handed and say, I think I need 500. They want you to really think about the process, which is driving your basically budgets and your plan.
Any questions on that? Capital asset budget? Okay, so the cash flow budget. This is, you know, as I've seen a lot of it, you've probably seen a lot of this too. This is definitely an area that a lot of entrepreneurs, small business owners, they run into trouble is the management of cash flow.
To be honest with you, if you take one thing away from this presentation, the difference between income and the difference between income and cash flow is what I want you to take away. And I'm going to go through a little bit more through a full example, but this is where startups and early entrepreneurs get into trouble, is they could be making a ton of money on an earnings basis, but they're cash poor. So they've secured these contracts, they've, you know, okay, I know I made this much because I sold this to Johnny for $1,000 and it only cost me 200, so I made 800. But you don't have that cash until he pays you, right? So we'll go through that example, but that's the one thing that I hope you take away from it is the difference between cash flow and income.
Yeah, exactly. So to sum that up, you can be profitable, but you can have a little cash flow. A lot of that information is going to come from some of the things we talked about already, but understanding the trends, understanding the cycles of your business. A lot of it's about timing, right? So like, when is the sale made and when is the cash actually going to be in your hands, right? And on the other side, when you have to pay for the resources that it takes to generate that revenue. How can you look for ways to create like a safety net for yourself and give yourself a buffer so that when you run into some areas where you're falling short of cash, you know, how can you plan for that? How can you plan for that? So again, not only in the startup, but as your company grows, you're going to need to look at the changes, like how your cash flow is changing, depending on how your sales are changing, right? So it's something that's going to be adaptive. It's going to be updated as you learn more about your business and as you kind of see those trends come to reality. And it shows you more and more detail with that. So the other thing that I didn't mention for capital asset budget, but also you see the financing there at the bottom. You're also going to see that here on this slide we're talking about cash flow budget. So Joe will talk more about that in a minute about some financing options. And when you look at capital assets, you want to see, you know, how do you match up the type of asset that you're buying and how long you're expecting it to last for. How do you match that up with the financing that you're looking at to purchase that? And then, again, like I said, when you're looking at your cash flow budget and you see some areas where you have a shortfall, what is the best way to try and make up for that? What kind of financing can you use in order to do that? Anybody any questions so far? So this is just a quick look at some of the ins and outs, where your cash is coming from. So operating activities, obviously sales, that's going to be bringing your cash in. Investments, that might be your startup cash. You know, you put some money, you inject some money into the business when you get started. Maybe you have some investors along with you or other shareholders, and you're kind of pulling your resources. At a bigger scale, you might see the last one says financial activities. Actually selling shares or issuing bonds, but in this case that's not really practical. So it's going to be more of lending money or borrowing money from the bank, injecting your own cash and then maybe possibly depending on your venture, you'll have some other people kind of join and pull some resources. And then on the other side of it, the cash going out, obviously, again, your operating activities, your expenses that are going to be paying on a regular basis. You also have some investing activities, cash outflow, so like you said, purchasing some a large piece of equipment, maybe purchasing your inventory to get your business started. And also on the financial side, or the financing side of it, if you borrowed some money, you're going to need to eventually pay that back. So when do you have to pay that back? How much and how long does that affect? Okay, again, so critical when you're looking at the cash flow budget, timing of it, trend analysis, you want to learn, you want to really have your head wrapped around the cycles that your business goes through. Okay, so Joe's going to go into more detail about the setup, the formula, how it works. And I guess just from an overview where it says identify the peaks and valleys, that's really what you're looking at when you're looking at cash flow budget. Really what you want to be able to identify.
I would like to look at it in extremes. Like, I work on a lot of construction companies, and I tell my employees not to go, you know, buying equipment or gear. And with construction, a lot of construction companies, they're busy in the summer and they're slow in the winter, right? So all of a sudden, stuff picks up in, you know, May, June, July, and they need a bunch of money because they're spending money in order to earn money. And then all of a sudden in December, January, February, they don't need so much cash anymore. So typically, I'll talk about the type of facility that they would have later. It's the type of facility, it's called an operating line. Basically what it does is it allows them to borrow a bunch of money today and pay it back really quickly. So it's not like a mortgage, like you guys know. You go, if you want to prepay your mortgage or pay it off in one shot, if you won the lottery, you might have to pay some sort of fee because they don't want you prepaying that mortgage, right? Whereas this facility allows you to borrow $1 million today for a week, and you can pay back $1 million a week from now once you collect your receivables. So,
okay. So, and this is going to be driven. The cash flow budget is going to be driven from your forecast, by your sales forecast, your expense forecast. So, like I said in the onset, you'll sort of see how everything is tied together, right? So, you've got your market research that you've done. You can use that to create your sales forecast. Your sales forecast is then going to flow into your cash flow budget, right? And then the same thing on the expense side as well. Again, being realistic, being conservative. You don't want to overestimate or underestimate. It's good to be optimistic, like Joe was saying, and you can't help but have that in a position you're in. You know, it's exciting to get out there and start your business, but you don't want to make that mistake of budgeting improperly because of that.
The problem with being overly optimistic is that if you're trying to get money from me, I'm the guy with the money, and you want me to invest in your business, you come in and tell me you're going to make $10 million in the first month, you almost lose credibility with me, right? It's like if you're going to come in and be that outlandish, unless you got the next Facebook or something like that, but if you're going to come in, it's almost like, okay, did this guy really, or girl, really put the time in to think about this plan, or is he just trying to get my money? And he thinks the way that he's going to get it is by telling me we can make $10 million in the first month, right? So that's why, again, we always come back to it. But you want to be optimistic and excited about the project, but you don't want to be, you know, out in space with your thought process.
Yeah. Okay, so this is just a quick overview of financial statements. Again, it's stuff that you've most likely seen before in accounting class if you've taken one, or I don't know if you've gone through this in this program, but is everybody familiar with what a balance sheet is?
If you're not, it's a balance sheet, like if you've never actually seen a company balance sheet, the way I try to think about it is, it's, has anybody ever done a personal net worth statement on their own thing, right? Like you might have some cash in the bank, a vehicle, a house, and then you've got some debt. You've got a car loan, a mortgage. It's the same thing, just different assets and different debt instruments.
Yeah, it's basically right? what you owe, or sorry, what you own, right? Your assets and what you owe would be your liabilities. So, and it's at a specific point in time, right? So your business is gonna have a year end, column one would be December 31st, right? So at December 31st, what's everything that you own and what's everything that you owe, right? It gets into detail about specifically how a balance sheet is made, where you wanna have, you know, assets listed in order of liquidity. In other words, things that can be turned into cash very quickly. So on the asset side, the current assets, they'd be very liquid. Cash would be obviously cash. Something like accounts receivable. So if you're selling a product or you're offering a service, you have credit terms, right? You sell someone today, but you let them pay you maybe in 30 days or 60 days. Those would be accounts receivable. Those would be turned into cash pretty quickly. So those would also be considered current assets. Inventory is another current asset. That's something that hopefully you're going to be selling within the next year, right? Something you purchase and sell a lot of within a year. So that would be another example. That's obviously in contrast to a long-term asset, which is some capital assets like we talked about before. So a piece of equipment or a building or a vehicle would fall into that area. Okay, so on the liability side, again, these are things that you owe. So we talked about the financing, you know, you get a mortgage, you get a line of credit. Those are obviously things that you have to pay back. On the other side of accounts receivable would be accounts payable. So if you're purchasing materials or inventory, you're going to be purchasing those on credit. So those would be something to consider on the liability side. And again, we list those in orders of liquidity. So accounts payable would be your current liability. Something long-term like your mortgage would be a long-term. And then the equity, well, that's the owner's investment. That's the startup capital that you put into the business. And that's also where the retained earnings is held. And we'll go into that in a second if you're not familiar with what retained earnings is. But okay, so this just gives you an actual example of, we've got the slides that are involved. And, so this is what an balance sheet looks like. And you can see there at the very bottom, like I said, so in the equity section, we've got the share capital or the owner's investment, and then you've got your retained earnings. So the retained earnings is an accumulation of your net profit or your net earnings each year.
That you left in there, right? So.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Drawn or taken out. And then you can see again what I was talking about, the breakdown to current assets, fixed assets, current liabilities, long-term liabilities. Okay, so in the income statement, again, I'm going to talk about sales forecast and revenue expense forecast. So, the revenue, obviously the sales and the service that you're providing, and the expenses are all those costs that we talked about that are going to happen on a monthly or yearly basis. Okay, and so your revenue minus your expenses is going to give you your net income. And your net income, your net earnings, profit, whatever you want to call it, that's going to flow into this retained earnings. Here. So that's how you see the statements are connected. Does anybody have any questions about that?
Why did you get a price on goodwill?
They're great price.
Yeah, goodwill is like in this case, or typically when you see goodwill on a balance sheet, it happens from a purchase of a business. So let's say I come and I purchase your business from you, and you've got hard assets $100,000. But I'm going to pay you $200 because you've got a client list, you've got supplier relationships, you know, you have a brand that people recognize. I'm going to pay you basically for those things. So coming out of my pocket is $200 of cash. $100 I'm going to set up on my opening balance sheet, they would call it, day one. I have the equipment that I bought from you. I have any receivables or payables that you left in the business for me to take over. So I'm buying those are hard assets, they go on the balance sheet. Then whatever I paid you in excess of those numbers is what they call goodwill. And the goal of running your own business is to generate a lot of what they call internal goodwill so that one day you can sell to me, even if you only have assets of $500,000, I'll pay you $1 million for it because you've developed all those intangible, internally generated items.
I think that's a really important way. I didn't realize from here, now
to explain it. Yeah. No, I think that's a good question because I know some of this stuff is like, you know, you look at it, it's like goodwill, what's that number? What does it mean, right?
The guy asked me to buy into his business.
Yeah.
And I said, okay, so what do we have here is business. Show me your income, show me your client list.
Mm-hmm.
He did everything under the table. He had nothing.
So he said,
he had that much goodwill, even though he had a lot of business.
Yes.
That much goodwill.
Yeah. That's why.
It's an extreme example. I've seen other examples where it's the flip side of it. I mean, goodwill's kind of a soft number, right? So
yeah.
You'll see a lot of times where it's inflated, where someone has come up with an idea of what they think is good amount based on the feeling that they have.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, it's definitely, that number is whatever is left after we've assigned values to what you have on your actual balance sheet, yeah. Right?
Between that and what you're actually fitting.
Exactly. And when you think about it, like let's say you got a business that's making $200,000 a year, right? In real life, somebody might be willing to pay you, but when you actually transact a business, this is a bit outside the scope of what we're talking about, but when you transact and purchase a business, a lot of people will pay you for the business's ability to generate cash, not necessarily the assets that are in the company. Because if I was just going to buy the assets, I could go buy the assets from anyone else. I want what the company's generating, and it's generating what it's generating because of those things we're talking about, like the brand. Like why does an NHL or an NBA franchise sell for $1 billion when it only makes $50 to $100 million? It's because of the brand. It's because somebody wants it, right? Like there's only 30 teams in each league, so somebody wants that team, and they're willing to pay in excess of the hard assets, which generates that goodwill. Okay. Yeah.
When do you decide? How do you decide the goodwill? Is it just when you sell the business?
So what happens is, it's that number is like a calculation that we would assist with based on when you go to sell a business, there's going to be what they call either an APA or an SPA, which is a purchase agreement for shares or a purchase agreement for assets, right? And what happens is we take that balance sheet and we fair value everything on it, and then you basically take the fair value of all the assets, purchase price that you said you're going to pay for it. So you go purchase price, and then you go less all the assets, less all the debt, gives you a number that I've paid in excess of what's showing on the sheets, and that's what dictates that number.
So in other words, it's got to be on a business combination, on a person business. You wouldn't start your own business and have goodwill on your own balance sheet.
Yeah, like when you start, you'll never have that number unless you do some sort of reorganization or somebody buys into your company. You won't have that until you actually transact.
And one more question. For that particular example, your goodwill is $350,000. Where does it go on the liability side?
There is no liability side for that. Like the goodwill is on there for $350,000 because that's what I paid for it. So the offset is included sort of in that retained earnings number.
Yeah,
okay? So if you're thinking, like, I don't know how much of what account, if you're thinking debits and credits,
yeah,
the debit is
question.
The goodwill and the credit is.
There's a lot of times you can see the asset match up with the liability, like a building has more. But in that case, yeah, that's kind of a main tricky area. Yeah. Okay, so here's an example. Again, we've got them to use an example of an income statement. Any questions about this?
Is everyone familiar with this statement? I feel like this is what most people, when they have a startup, an income statement is what you think of, right? Like, I'm gonna have sales, I'm gonna have costs, and here's what I'm gonna make. Has anyone ever seen one of those before?
So, statement of cash flows, and again, Joe's gonna go over an example for us pretty soon here, but what a cash flow budget would look like. So the cash flow statement, yeah, we have that as well if you want to follow along with the slides. So again, driven by your sales and your expenses, so you can see the sales side of cash coming in and from your operations, and then on the expense side, the cash that it's gonna take to run those operations, so the cash going out. We like to separate those into three areas, and you can see them moving better on here. So you have your cash flow from your operating activities, right? You're gonna have all your revenues and expenses that are gonna move in that area. And then your investing activities, so we spoke about that a little bit. Are you purchasing some capital assets? Are you having, like, let's say other investors inject some cash into the business? Those type of expenditures are gonna go in there. And then the financing activity. So cash coming in, again, the financing activity would be like a loan. You want to make a loan, that's your cash in. Then you start making payments on that loan, usually on a monthly basis. so that would be the cash flow going around. Matt, any questions about that? Have you seen that one? Cash flow savings?
That, I would say that's one of the most underrated statements. Like, whenever you take an accounting course, they really beat into you. You learn about the income statement, you learn how to record the transactions, you learn how to set up a balance sheet. But in school, they definitely neglect how important the cash flow statement is, because that really shows you, okay, what money have people sent me, and what money have I sent out of my company? Because at the end of the day, running a business is all about generating cash, right? You got a business that makes a bunch of money in terms of earnings, so you make $1 million, but you collect none of your receivables for whatever reason. Your cash balance is going to be zero at the end of the year, even though your income statement is going to show $1 million in profit. Right? So it's all about, you got to make sure you can collect your receivables. You got to be able to pay your suppliers on time so that you don't ruin your relationships with them. And that's what this statement helps you to do. Yeah. And cash flow budget, obviously.
And I mean, you know, a lot of businesses at some point or another are going to need to go to a bank, and banks are, you know, looking at cash flow statements, cash flow analysis. They want to know, you know, are they going to get their money back? Are you going to be able to repay? Right? So it's good for them. This area might be new to some of you. Pro forma financial statements, forward-looking financial statements. So these are where you take something like your income statement, let's say, and you would make projections based on that, and it would give you an idea of what you might be seeing in the next few months or the next year. A lot of this is driven by industry research and market research. So they can obviously help you make plans, long-term decisions. And it's also something that the banks look a lot at.
Typically, if you're going to borrow money from a bank and you don't really have, like, typically for startups, you don't really have, you know, an asset base. Like, if I go in and I've got $1 million worth of retained earnings and I've got a bunch of hard assets that I've already paid for with the earnings from my company, a bank might lend me some money just on those assets and say, yeah, okay, you're a healthy company, you've been in existence for 10 years, I got no problems giving you the money. But if you show up and you have no sales, no balance sheet, no history, they're gonna say, okay, so we don't have any historical information to base our decision on whether we're gonna give you the money or not. Can you put something together that is gonna show me what your company's gonna do for the next 2 years, or 12 months, or 3 years, right? And then they'll try and base their decisions off that.
Yeah. And then similar to how, when we're talking about the sales forecasting expense budget, the stronger that your assumptions are, the more market research you have to back it up, or the more industry data you have to show how you came up with those projections, the better off you're going to be, the better chance you're going to have when you walk into the bank and you look to borrow some money.
Yeah, so all these things are integrated, right? So you're going to have your qualitative stuff in your business plan, you're going to have your market research. And really, that should be, there should be a strong connection between that and what you're showing you're going to do in terms of a financial perspective, right? So whatever you're saying qualitatively, your market research should flow into these statements and your budgets and your forecasts. Yeah?
We're all starting a business,
mm-hmm,
and have no money, no sales. We need this information.
Yeah.
We jump to you folks.
Mm-hmm.
How do you charge typically for that kind of service? What's it look like?
We acknowledge that that obviously you guys haven't started yet, very regularly, you're a startup. So typically what we do is we try to help you get the money so that once you have money in the bank, you're able to pay us, right? So it's almost like we're not gonna send you a bill day one because we know you're probably not gonna pay it anyway because there's no cash in the bank right now, right? So typically with startups, like, we like to work with you guys on your side to get you the money that you need from the bank, right? And I'll get to it later, but there's other agencies, funding agencies that assist with providing financing, not for the business, but for coming up with a business plan, coming up with financial projections, because they know, like, you might have the idea, but you don't necessarily have the financial acumen, the commerce or the market research, right? You need help in that area. And these places know this, like Regional Business Center, I'm trying to think of the other ones, NYHFC, some of these places, literally, part of their mandate is to say, hey, you know what? You've given me your ID on paper. It intrigues me. Here's 5 or 10 grand. to go do whatever you need to do in terms of market research, coming up with a business plan, because they know the bank's going to need it, right? Or they're going to ask for it. Or any lender for that matter. It doesn't necessarily need to be a bank. It can be a shareholder, or angel investor, dragon fan, whatever you want, right? They're going to ask these questions. So there are ways to help finance the business plan, not necessarily the actual bricks and mortar up front. You know what I mean?
Excuse me, yeah. We have something more realistic, because the, those numbers, I never do that in my first year of business.
You're looking at the public cash flow?
Cash flow?
It's just an illustrative
example,
right?
Never, I will do that in my first year,
I know. It's more about the concepts though, right?
Okay.
It's more about the concepts. So take three zeros off all those numbers.
Yeah.
And it translates, right? Or divide every number by 10.
Because I've never do this kind of money. My first I'll do...
No, I know. It depends on the type of business, right? It's all just methodology and concept.
Okay.
It's just kind of getting an understanding of where those numbers come from.
Yeah.
And then what you can do with that information.
Okay.
Thank you.
Shouldn't be too much longer. Okay, so financing the startup. So basically the first thing I'm going to talk about is, you know, we've talked about coming up with this plan. Now, where do you go to try and get the money that you need to start your business, right? So bootstrapping is basically a concept that entails throwing your own money in, reinvesting the money that you have from another business into this business, or coming up with family money. Traditional lending is your typical go to the bank, right? They'll give you mortgages, they'll loan on equipment, they'll give you an operating line. Those are the traditional, like when people think I need money, it's go to the bank and get a loan, right? That's what falls under there. Equity injection, let's say I have an existing business, I'm making a little bit of money, but I have plans for future growth. James is a rich guy, and I know him, and we're buddies, and I say, I need 100 grand, do you want 50% of my business? He says, sure. His contribution is the 100 grand. I brought the idea, so that's 100 grand that goes into the business, and then we split the profits on a go-for, right? Leasing is, it's very similar to a term loan, which is basically just lending on a piece of equipment. So the difference between a term loan is the bank will give you, you know, 50 grand to go get a truck, and I go buy the truck, I own the truck, and I repay the bank. A leasing is somebody provides me with the truck, but they still own it, but I make monthly payments in order to secure the use of that vehicle or whatever asset it may be. Personal loans, pretty self-explanatory. Easiest money to find if you have it is in your own bank account, right? And then these were the two that I was kind of touching on before, the Canada Small Business and the NOHFC grants and FedMo. Basically, these agencies have been created and their mandate is to give money away, okay? FedNor and NOHFC especially, some of their programs, if you're in Northern Ontario and you're looking to either create an innovative process, create an innovative product, create jobs in the North, if you can show them that that's what your plan is going to do and your startup business is going to do, they're more than willing to give money, and it comes sometimes in terms of a grant, which is, it's like a direct, it's almost free money. Or sometimes they'll do half loan, half equity. So they'll say, we're willing to give you $100,000 for your startup. 50 goes directly to you, you do whatever you want with it, you don't have to pay us back if you meet certain conditions. So I'll say create 5 jobs in the first year. And then the other 50,000 is repayable over 5 years at a very beneficial interest rate. So these types of things, guys, if you're looking to start up, and they have a ton of different programs, I would go to their website and look and see if you guys fit the profile for any of these specific programs, because there's a ton of them, and like their job is to give the money out to people from Northern Ontario. I've seen ones, young entrepreneurs, so if you're under 26 or 27 and you're starting a business, what are the ones that they have?
The regional business Center actually has a funding handbook that outlines all of the different financing options, including grants and loans.
For Canada Small Business, or the Regional Business Center? For NOHFC and FedNor, or for the role thing?
Every funding opportunity that exists, we have the funding handbook. It's available on our website, and we have...
Exactly. And there's like, I've seen ones on your guys' website too. I think you have like summer, not summer internships, but like starting a summer job for a student, right? You'll $5,000 to go buy whatever you guys need, a lawnmower and a snowboard. Yeah, no, I know. So there's good programs out there. You just need to look and find them, right?
Yeah. Seniors entrepreneurial program.
I'll look into it. And then like you were talking about before, angel capital, right? So typically what angel investors are is someone who is usually self-made. So they've come up, say, in the mining industry, they started their own company, they made a ton of money, and now they've got it in them that they want to help people who are like them, who struggle to get capital, and they want to get them off the ground, right? So that's just like if you guys have ever watched Dragon's Den, typically what they do is they're investing in products that they understand, right? Like sometimes you'll see the guy stay or the women say, this isn't really my sector, so I gotta back out. But if it's tech and the tech investor is there, he's like, this is a great idea, I get it, let's do it, right? So typically they'll give anywhere from 25 to 100 grand, depending on the startup and the idea, to get you going. And then usually they'll back you when you get to certain stages, right? So you're at the seed stage right now. Once you start getting to sort of maturity and growth stage, they'll be like, hey, things are going well. Here's another 500, here's another million. Right? So that's that slide.
Is there a difference between an angel and a venture capitalist?
Angel would be more of an individual who has come from that spot and understands what it's like to struggle and is specific to a certain industry. A VC would be, it could be a big company who's got, like Apple has $1 billion in the bank, and they say, hey, let's start a VC and we'll just invest in all these little startups, right? So I'd say a VC is probably a little less personal than an angel investor. And a VC, they're typically, they have a mandate as well where it's okay, we give 100 grand, but we want an exit strategy in 4 years. So they want to liquidate their investment as quick as they can. And they're typically looking for returns of like 10 times their money, right? So it's like did anyone see Snapchat when IPO a couple days ago? There would be venture capitalists in there that basically said, we don't care if Snapchat could go to $1 million a share in the next 10 years. We've set our guidelines and we're getting out on day one. We're gonna cash out our investment because we got in at the ground level and now it's worth $25 billion. So we're good with that. We're taking our money and we're running.
So you've been, with each of these, you can set up the parameters, even if say an angel investor, you can set up a parameter to say in the first, after 5 years, buy you out again, or
you can definitely set agreements up like that, or like, I mean, typically with angel investors, they're willing to work with you, right? And they want to see you succeed. That's why they're investing in you, because they could put their money elsewhere if they have it and put a coupon forever, right? So they're in it to help you. So there's a bit, like I said, a bit more of a personal element to it there. They want to see you succeed as well as make money. But you can definitely set up agreements like that, negotiations like that. So that was where you go. Now it's, I've decided where I want to go, what types of financing vehicles are there, right? So we talked a little bit about an operating line before, which is basically used to fund your short-term cash needs. So in the example I'm going to show you, you're going to see that the business owner we have is that he's in the manufacturing business and he creates whatever, widgets, right? And he knows he's able to sell something at the end of the month, and he only collects that 30 days from when he sells it. But in order to get the inventory to the customer when they buy it, he's got to basically prepay all his expenses and whoever he's buying the product off to get it to that person, right? So it's almost like day one, I got to pay 10 grand to get the product that I'm going to sell. Then I sell it, and then I collect it 30 days after I sell it. So you almost got like a 60-day lag where you're basically out cash, right? So an operating line helps finance those struggles and cover the shortfall in the short term. Because once you collect your receivables 2 months from then, you have money in the bank, you can pay it down right away, right? Like, does anyone have a personal line of credit?
Yeah.
Yeah, it works the exact same way. You can go cut a check for 10 grand right now if you wanted to, right? And pay it back tomorrow. Yeah. So it's for those short-term cash needs. Term loans, James talked about this a little bit. What they try to do with a term loan is they look at the asset and they say, you know, I'm gonna generate this amount of cash flow on a long-term asset over the next 5 years. What they try to do is match the payments that you need to make on that debt along with how you're gonna earn the cash flow. So if a piece of equipment is gonna earn you $50,000 a year net of cash flow, they try to line the payments up to be $50,000 a year, right? So that as you're generating income, you can pay them back over the life of that asset. Mortgages, pretty self-explanatory. I'm sure a lot of people have one in here. Typically used for land building. If you're in the manufacturing business and you need a facility, even if you're selling retail and you need a warehouse, right? Same type deal. Typically it's 20, 25, 30 years at a specified rate. And again, they're just trying to match the cash flows. Like, they know you're gonna own that for the next 30 years, right? So they're not gonna make you pay for it all up front because they know you don't have the money to do that. That's what they're there for. Leases, very similar to term loans, except for the exception of where I told you how the lessor, the person you're leasing it off, still owns the asset legally. Shareholder loans, again, it's just putting your own money in. And then the other thing, like, you guys see, when you get to that point where you're actually going to sit down with a banker, it can be pretty intimidating. And like, banking agreements can be that thick, very intricate. Terms and conditions, you feel like you're almost signing your life away sometimes, right? And that's why I think it's very important that you go seek, once you get to that point, seek some advice, especially if you're borrowing a significant amount of money, right? If you're borrowing $15,000 and you know, if things blow up, I can pay it off and it'll be fine, it's not gonna affect my life, that's okay. That's one thing, but if you're borrowing like $500,000 and the bank wants you to pledge your personal home and assets as security, and you gotta repay it over a certain amount of time that might be tighter than what your cash flows are dictating, you basically don't wanna go broke if things don't work out in the business, right? So it's worth talking to an accountant. If you borrow a lot of money, they probably will require a personal guarantee. That basically is you pledging your assets, right? Because they're not in the business of losing money, so they're gonna take whatever they can get, right? So just like I said, it's very, if you ever read through one, it's pretty intricate. It's in legal jargon, right? So it's, I don't know who's ever read a contract. Sometimes it feels like you're reading it in a different language, right? So it's worth getting a professional to help you out.
So that would be a lawyer that would be talking?
Well, for a bank agreement, I would say an accountant,
okay,
for sure. The lawyer is probably the person on the other side drafting it up, right, for the bank. So definitely just worth asking the question before you sign something, and then you're into it and you can't get out of it, right? Okay. So what do lenders typically look for? When I think about that question, I think about, I put myself in their position. If somebody was asking me for my money, what would I require from that person, right? So basically, a well-thought-out business plan that is feasible is basically everything we just talked about, right? It's being realistic. It's showing them that the market's there. It's showing them that the cash flows are gonna be good. They're not gonna be like astronomically great because they might just punch you out the door and say it doesn't make sense, right? It's about acknowledging and identifying all the costs that you think are gonna come with doing this. The more that you can identify and the more support for your assumptions and other information that you can put into your business plan to show the banker or the angel investor or whoever that you've thought about these things, the more credibility you're gonna have.
Yeah, in a lot of cases, unless you're coming up with something completely new or that's never been seen before, bankers are gonna know, they've seen these business plans before, and something that's specific or similar to the business that you're running. So if you're way off track compared to other things they see in the industry, they're gonna notice that right away. And you're not gonna be successful, they're not.
Okay, and depth of management experience and professionalism. So this is one that I think definitely goes a long way. It's a qualitative factor, right? Like, if somebody's gonna invest in you, it's not because they know like hard dollars start spitting out tomorrow. It's because they know you can manage the business that they're investing in. So one of the things I think about is, I think, you know, even if you've never ran your own business before, if you've been in a position where you managed somebody or worked on a project together with a group, or you know, maybe you headed up a division for a large company, or even if you're used to working in a large company where you ran a crew, right? Those are worth putting on your resume, because as much as they're investing in your business and your idea, you're the one who's going to bring it to fruition, right? So that's why they do place reliance on that. As much as everyone thinks it's about the numbers, it's not just about the numbers. There's other factors you need to consider. Creditworthiness, same deal. Like if I go try and get a $10,000 credit card, they're going to run my credit score. If you have a history of repaying, what are the odds are? It's better that you're going to get the loan or the credit card, right? It's the same deal for a business. And to be honest with you, sometimes they don't just look at the business's creditworthiness, they look at you personally as well, because if you have a history of repaying, odds are if you're running that business, you're going to repay your debt as well, right? Earnings potential, pro forma financial statements, that's what James talked about. Obviously, it's a vital component. They want to make sure they're going to get their money back, right? Order investment, so at least 10%. That's obviously, it's just a general number. Typically they ask for 10%, and a lot of people think like, okay, what do you need my money for? Your bank, right? But they want to see that you have some skin in the game. Because if you don't have skin in the game and things get tough, it's real easy to wash your hands and walk away, right? And they're the ones that get stiff, basically. So it's more of a good faith thing, making sure that you're in it just as much as they are. And they acknowledge like, hey, I know you're here because you need money. So you're asking me for $1 million. If you put in 50 or 100 grand, it's all relative, right? Like me putting 50 grand in is the same as the bank putting $1 million on a relative scale. So they just want to make sure that you're in it the same as they are. Pledge of security, we talked about that already, sort of personal guarantees. Banks will, if they look, and let's say you have an existing business and you have existing assets that are completely paid off, a lot of times the banks will loan on those assets, because banks like to loan on hard assets, right? If they can go in and take something and liquidate it and get their money back if things go awry, that's what they prefer. So they'll take a security charge on it, which basically means if things do go bad, I can come in. I have the ability to come in and take it, okay?
What about previous debt problems?
Previous debt problems?
Yeah.
Like if you had it, or if your company had it, or?
Yeah.
They definitely will look at it. That would probably fall on your creditworthiness and your experience, previous experiences, right? It's like, I'm not gonna lie to you, if you've gone bankrupt or you've ran a company that went bankrupt, it's gonna be harder for you to get money the second time, right? It just always is.
There are some secondary lenders, like people basing, yes, that, you know, have been turned down by
a
bank.
Yeah, yeah, no, there's definitely, and that's why I think, like, we have a slide at the end that has a lot of these specialized lenders, but it doesn't, like, I think you really gotta think, okay, I know what I wanna do, I know where I can get my money.
Yeah.
You almost gotta find what's the best fit for you, right? Where you can go get your money. Because nickel basin's a great example, right? They're a different type of lender.
Yeah.
And different people fit differently with different lenders, right? So you gotta know your profile and know the profile of the lender.
Yeah.
And you just gotta put two and two together, so. So this chart is basically just trying to show how you match your financing to your needs. So when you have, like, you basically have three types of assets. You have your fixed assets, which is the things we're talking about, your equipment, your bricks and mortar, facilities, some vehicles, and then you have permanent current assets. Now this is sort of what I like to call kind of working capital, and it's the working capital that you'd like to have in your business no matter what time of the year or how busy you are. So at a bare minimum, you want to have a certain amount of cash in the bank, right? Like some people might say, oh, I'm comfortable running my business with 50 grand in cash at all times. Some people might say, I can do it with 10. Some people might say, I'd like to have 100 just in case. So those are those, so it's a current asset, but it's kind of not going anywhere just based on the way you run your business, right? And then you have what they call fluctuating current assets, which is, let's say you get a big order tomorrow, right? So you have this and this that are kind of set numbers. Oh my God, I need a bunch more cash because I gotta fill an order for 500 grand that I wasn't expecting. You know what I mean? So that's what that line is. And I'll show you basically what this translates to on this slide. Oh, I thought it was a different slide. I mean, okay, so they're basically saying finance these types of assets with this type of debt, which is previous retained earnings and long-term debt, and finance these big fluctuations that you're going to have if you're a seasonal business or you get big contracts with the short-term debt. And the short-term debt that we're referring to there would be like an operating line of credit, right? So the ability to write a cash tomorrow or write a check tomorrow because I got paid for the inventory that I'm going to sell here, and then I can pay it off right here, so it's not going to cost me an arm and a leg to keep that debt outstanding, okay? Okay, so now this is the example. It's, you have it in your notes, and obviously you can go through it in a little more detail if you want on your own, but I'll go through it pretty quick. So basically we've got John, he created a new product, it's the next best thing. He's expecting exponential growth, right? So he's thinking, I'm gonna sell 5 units, then 100 units, then 200 units, then 500 units. So he's gonna have a significant amount of growth. Whenever you have a significant amount of growth, that's when you need the ability to write a check, right? To fill orders, basically. So, okay, he did his analysis. He's expecting a good amount of growth. He's gonna collect his revenue 30 days after the sale. So that basically means I give James his inventory and send him a bill. He pays me 30 days from that point, okay? Due to the lead time in the manufacturing process, I need to let my supplier know basically a month ahead of time before I make the sale to James so that they can basically make it and get it ready, and I need to pay for it, right? Like typically when you go to buy a decent amount of stuff, someone's gonna say either put a deposit down or like at the seed stage, you don't really have much credit. Like you haven't established credit with customers, right? So they're gonna want you to pay up front. They'll send you the stuff and then I can send it to James. And then the owner plans to draw $2,500 a month. So that's basically his salary. He's got to live, right? And that's a fixed cost. It's not going to change. In real life, it could change, but for sake of the example, it's not going to change. He's got $50,000 to start his business, and he has another $25,000 available from his family member. Yes, family member. Okay, so this is the sales projection, okay? So this is the part where I wanted you guys to really think about the difference between a sales forecast and basically earnings and cash flow. And you're gonna see how they're drastically different. So when you look at this business, it's pretty healthy, right? First month, obviously, I haven't secured any orders yet, but I still paid myself, so I'm in the whole $2,500 in terms of earnings. It makes 12.5, which translates, if you add all these up, it translates to about $750,000 or $275,000 in earnings for the first 6 or 7 months, okay? So this is the growth we were talking about. This is just scaling the revenue forecast, basically, right? Saying, again, going from 12.5, 37.5, 62.5. So it's a pretty high scale, right? So from there, we know in January, here's what my cash flow looked like. I had $50,000 I put in. That was step one, right? And I paid myself $2,500. So it's not shown here, but you cash it down a little bit, right? Second month goes by into February, and this is where I want to show you. So this is the cost of sales, right? Remember the example, I'm forced to pay for my inventory. I got to give my supplier a month's time before he gives it to me. So I pay him day one, he builds the inventory that I need to sell to James. So I pay for it in January, but it only comes to the earnings once I sell it to James. So here, so these two numbers sort of contrast, right? And then the thing is when people look at this, they're like, oh, okay, yeah, I made $37.50, that's good, right? But the problem is, I think it's on this one, is I don't collect this $12,500 that I sold to James until March. So when you match it up, I'm really out of pocket, all that cash, I'm out $62,500 for 1 month, and then I finally collect this sale in the next month. So it's a 60-day lag where basically you're out of pocket before you collect anything, right? And when we look at the example, because he's got so much growth, he has a cash shortfall here, right?
So it's almost gross. Sorry, it grows. If you can see the difference between February and March sales. how it jumps up to 18,750 in the cost of sales in March, and that's just going to be cumulative, right? So that's adding in February, so you've already got that cash outlay of 6,250, and then you're going to add to that the following month, right?
It's basically, so you got to spend more money to make more money, right? So in order to supply or get that sale out, I've got to spend a bunch of money in March to deliver that to him in April, and he's only going to pay me the following month, right? So if you look at this, it really goes 62.5, so I pay, and then it hits my earnings. I pay, and then it hits my earnings. I pay, and then it hits my earnings. And it goes the same deal for revenue, right? I send a bill to James, he pays me in March. Send a bill to James, he pays me in April, right? So that's why I want you to see the difference between, because if anybody, if you didn't see this blog post, say, man, that's a healthy business, that's great, right? I'm in. But when you look at the cash flows, they run out of cash. So basically, if you took the $25,000 loan and started with $75,000 from the family member, all of a sudden you eliminate that cash shortfall, right? So the point in all this is basically to come up with what you think your projected earnings are going to be, and then cash flow it out. Yeah, so where's my cash balance going to fall at the end of each month, right?
That ties into like the peaks and valleys that we're talking about.
Exactly.
So I think what happens a lot of times too is when you hit that high point, if you don't have a proper cash flow projection or budget, you hit that high point, you see a lot of cash in there, you start spending, right?
Yeah, no, and one of the things that like you need to think about is it'd be easier if you had, let's say you had a customer lined up and you knew you had it lined up in January. You start like this, you only find out the problem in March. And at that point, it becomes a lot harder to go get the money from the bank, and you don't have time because you're trying to fill orders, right? So my advice would be, if you do know that you have a good plan, and maybe you do have some interest from a customer, right? Go to the bank and secure a line of credit before you start this process and know these numbers so you know, okay, I'm probably going to run out of money in March, April, and May. So what do I need? Well, I was short $25. So if I go borrow $25,000 or at least have it available, I should be okay. And showing the bank, like there's nothing wrong with this. The bank loves this, right? And the bank knows what this means. This isn't a bad thing. If you go there acknowledging that, that's what they're there for, is to cover that downfall, right? So you're only going to be ahead with the bank if you can show them, listen, here's how it's going, we're making money, I just need to finance the operations for short term, will you help me out? They'd be all over it.
Yep. So is it people like the regional business office or you folks who would help us folks develop something?
This would definitely be up our alley. Some people can do it on their own. I think what a lot of people are good at doing is coming up with these numbers, right? The revenue and the expenses, because you kind of know, like, I mean, this owner knew, I'm gonna pull up $2,500 a month for my salary. These numbers are probably, revenue is probably driven off of, I know I got orders for 500 widgets and I'm gonna sell them each for $200. So it's relatively simple to come up with those numbers, right? Obviously with the right thought process and doing the right market research. Cost of sales is a number driven off basically what you want to earn on each sale. So if you say I want to make 25% on each sale, then you just kind of back into this number, right? Like, or it could be a direct item. If you know to make one widget it's going to cost $10, then take the number of widgets you're going to sell and multiply by 10, right? And that drives your gross margin. So like I said, these numbers are typically what people come to us with. And they come, and they don't necessarily come with those, but they might come with the assumptions that build those, right?
Yeah.
First thing I'll ask you is, do you have any contracts? Or how many are you expecting to sell, right? And what are you gonna sell them for? And then I can drive these numbers for you, or James can drive the numbers for you. This is the part that definitely gets a little more intricate, and building the balance sheet and the income statement as a total, like on an annual basis or even on a monthly basis. So that's where we would help you out, basically. And the bank knows that. Like, the bank knows, they can tell when an accountant's prepared a cash flow projection or an owner, right?
They're gonna probably be happier with something that the accountant has prepared.
Well, that's the other thing too, right? Like, well, basically what we would do is we would prepare it. Typically what we like to do is make sure that the assumptions are viable. And we say, you know, these are management's assumptions, but they appear plausible right now. And here's what, if their assumptions come to fruition, here's what the picture would look like, right? So that's typically what we would assist with. But other than that, I think that's all we got, okay?
Yes. I have one more question.
Yes.
I forget the name of the companies or the genre of the, they will buy your invoice for a percentage of.
Oh, factor.
Factor.
Yes, factor.
It's a strange name.
And that, yeah, that it definitely is a more complex concept.
Pros and cons.
Well, the pros of it are you get your money today, right? And you offload the credit risk to someone else, typically a big bank or something, right? And where you see that a lot is when a company is smaller, but they have big customers, right? Because big customers know they can squeeze their suppliers. Because I'm your biggest customer, you need me, right? So I'm only gonna pay every 180 days. If you don't like it, I'll find the next guy, and he'll take it, you know what I mean? So what factoring does is it basically says, I have this receivable from this big company. They obviously have the money to pay it. They're just choosing to have credit terms that are 180 days versus the traditional 30 or 60, right? So what they do is they buy the receivable off you and then they collect it from that company. But you have to pay them a fee. So you might only get 95% of your receivable.
So typically they might take 5%?
Oh, they'll take a fee for sure.
I know they'll take a fee, but what's typical?
I think it depends on the customer. I don't want to give you numbers because I'm not a banker, but I'd say, you know, if you're 2 to 5%, you're probably in the range. But if you're going to do something like that, I'd say definitely look around, right? Like shop around and you'll get a sense of what the banks are offering.
Yeah.
Okay? This is the list that we were talking about earlier. I'll let you guys get out of here, but this is basically all the good funding agencies that I've dealt with from time to time. And their mandate is to get startups like you guys money.
And the regional business center, in addition, just to piggyback on the question you asked a moment ago, so definitely see a chartered accountant for, you know, your complex financials, that sort of thing. But for the business plan that can accompany the financials and some of the other supports, we're there as well to help guide you through the process. And we also have services that are free of charge as well, and handbooks and guides and stuff. So for those, you know, maybe with a big startup budget, come see us and we'll try and.
So at what point would you start charging us for?
The regional business center services are all free of charge.
Well, you said something about, I thought you just intimated there that there was a point where you'd charge.
No, then you would expand to the agency that. But the regional business center didn't help me find another
one. Absolutely, yeah.
And it's always good to use the resources available, right? Like, nothing hurts from going down to see these guys and sit down
for stuff.
Exactly. Right. Yeah.
Then it gets to a point where you need to.
Yeah,
and then we'll refer you out to, you know, your
accountants,
your lawyer, that sort of thing. So,
all right. Everybody good? Any other questions? Good. Thanks, guys.
Thanks for coming out.